Matt had written a proposal to the government to make this area a protected area. And the government thought it was a great idea for research and protection for the environment and agreed. And in 1990, on Earth Day, 1990, this area became officially declared. Matt was also big on developing the community homestays. So he would be all over the country, Gill's Point, St. Margaret's, Bermuda Landing, and everywhere he went, everybody knew him and loved him, and they all became part of that family to host our students. So we all became like this big family supporting conservation, education, and community. He was a monkey, but he was also a monkey because he couldn't sit still. He was involved in everything. He wanted to be part of everything. He was a co-founder with SWA, and he brought in Lighthawk to Belize, and he was the country director. And he was very active in community services and all that. So he was a people lover and a nature lover to the core. He really, 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 really loved Belize. I mean, he couldn't think of any other place that he wanted to be than Belize. And this is where he is, and this is where he also unfortunately passed, but that would have been his wish anyhow.
I've known Matt for over 25 years and worked very closely with him over that time frame. And he was a visionary, he was a conservationist, and he was a people's person. He not only was the founder of the Monkey Bay Wildlife Sanctuary and the visionary for the Monkey Bay National Park and the establishment of the Tobacco Key Marine Station, but he was the first person I actually heard the word watershed from. And Matthew played a significant role in helping to establish and lead the first watershed association in Belize, the Siboney River Watershed Association. He was also the country director for Lighthawk, which did many years of conservation flights over the country. And he involved government officials, national park managers, community leaders, students, educators, and so many people having the opportunity to get a view of the country and its natural resources. But coming more specifically to his working relationship with the Belize Audubon Society, he not only served for 2 years as a Peace Corps volunteer, but Matt was instrumental in identifying a donor back in the early 1990s for 100 pairs of binoculars and 100 Peterson Mexican birding field guides and National Geographic birding field guides for distribution over the entire country. And out of his goodness of his heart, Matthew led a Monkey Bay Wildlife Sanctuary birding team on the Christmas bird counts, specifically the Belize City Christmas bird count, where he would take canoes out to Mussel Creek, and also on the Siboney River at the Siboney Bridge, he would pack up his vehicle, gather up a team, and religiously participate in those two Christmas bird counts. From my perspective, Matthew has left an indelible print on the conservation map of Belize.
I first met Matt Miller probably in 1988 when he was working for the Peace Corps. And my wife and I were building and operating a field station in the Mountain Pine Ridge at the Thousand Foot Falls. And Matt used to come up for a visit. And we began to talk about conservation in Belize. And over the next few years, we began to scheme about strategies that would be making a major impact in the country. And that's when we came up with the idea of the watershed component. So we created an education program around the watershed back when he first started this field station. And I was involved in teaching the first courses with him when the students began to arrive. And we continue doing that up until now. I'm still involved with Monkey Bay. Well, the word visionary is used often when you talk about Matt, because that's exactly what he was. He was a visionary. And also, very importantly, he was an organizer, and he was able to pull people together and find a common cause and help to motivate that common cause. And so he was always helping to focus the attention on those areas of conservation where we need to be focused most. And of course, water and watersheds are key to conservation in Belize, and still are today. And with the Sabun Watershed Association, that helped to make watershed a household word. And again, Matt was one of the pioneers in helping to form that very important first watershed association in the country. And today there are several other watersheds associations that have sprung from that. Well, I think Matt's legacy is going to continue, because the work that he's initiated is continuing. And I see where more and more the conservation organizations are turning to the important work of conserving the watersheds themselves. For many, many years, focus has been in the marine environment, but now everybody realizes how important it is to conserve watersheds to conserve the marine environment. And watersheds are the essential part of the hydrologic cycle that keeps everything going. Still a lot of work to do, and we'll continue that effort in Matt's name.
So yeah, growing up with Matt and my dad, he would always take me on these excursions with student groups. And so I got to travel a lot when I was younger, and we were riding around in this, you know, old school bus with 15 to 20 foreign students that are super jazzed about being in Belize. And it was just a really amazing time. And watching Matt interact with the students, interact with local people, and building relationships that were not only long-standing, but fruitful for everyone involved, because everyone wanted to help out each other and find a way to contribute to the mission that was taking place here at Monkey Bay and in Belize at large. You know, the conservation effort in Belize has been really kind of an example for the rest of the world since the late 80s, when that movement really kicked off. So I never really accepted that my dad would stop doing the work that he was doing. I was under the impression that he was going to continue doing that for the rest of his life, even though he was looking for retirement. He just was that kind of person where, even though he says he's like, you know, I want to retire, I knew he was still going to be involved, because it was such a passion project for him that I never really considered a reality without him here at Monkey Bay. So until the point where he became ill, to the point where he couldn't carry out that role anymore, it was kind of a really heavy moment for me. But what I wanted to highlight with the nomination for the James A. Waight Award was his qualities as a visionary, because from the very beginning in the early 90s, he had this vision and this understanding that conservation comes at a cost. If you're going to protect land, you need to find a way to provide funding to do that. And so he, through his experiences in college and, you know, working with his counterparts at Peace Corps, he came up with this idea to have a study abroad or environmental education facility where you could attract foreign visitors, do a specific course targeted at, whether that be watershed ecology, ancient Mayan history, ethnobotany, what have you. Those curriculum were the things that attracted students to come here. And by staying here, they were providing funding to carry out all the conservation work. And I think that he's a visionary in the sense that even today, a lot of these conservation organizations that are springing up, some of them might be, you know, well-established, but they still haven't found a way to establish their own financial sustainability mechanisms. And I think that from the very beginning, that was the first thing that Monkey Bay really got established for itself and has continued to build up over the years, is its financial sustainability mechanism that is, it actually complements very, very well the work that is being done in the field. When you're teaching people about the work and why it's important, and also when you teach people about what's happening out in the field, and then they're directly contributing to that work through, you know, the contracting of services, it ties the whole room together, so to speak. Like, everything complements each other so well. And I think Monkey Bay is probably one of the first organizations or groups in Belize to market study abroad as like a specific subset of tourism. And it's the organization's ability to be self-sustainable with finances is really kind of sets it apart from other organizations.